Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Anto Liivat, and I'm working as a management lecturer here in EBS, and I'm very delighted to welcome you all here today on the seminar organized to celebrate the EBS 25th anniversary. We are going to have an introductory lecture right after we have kindly accepted the greetings from Estonian Association of Small and Medium Enterprises.
Tervist, lugupeetud rektor, lugupeetud saali kuulajad. Ma loodan, et ma võin eesti keeles rääkida kõik sellest. Ülejäävalt suur au õnnitleda EBS-i kui valitud erakõrgkooli selle värida tähtava kogu. 25 aastat tähistab kindlasti seda aastakosti, kus positiivsest on saanud mees ja tütarlaps on saanud naises. Soovin ere vabust EBS-ile tüdrukad teistas. Ere tähistas samasugust tähtpäeva olnud see, kõik me oleme päris üle eraad. EBS ei ole mitte ainult kõrgkond. EBS on äriettevõte. EBS on üks neid äriettevõte, mis alustas ettevõtlusega siis, kui Eesti on veel ise sellises. Aga ettevõtlus juba tähtis. Need olid tõepoolest alguses peale riigis. Ja EBS-i pannus Eesti äriettevõtluse, Eesti ärihariduse kasvatamise, ma arvan, on kirjeldatud. EBS-i võib-olla ei oleks, kui EBS-i ees eestvedaja asutaja Madis Avakuk ei oleks olnud õigel ajal EBS kohas. Eile EREA autosustas oma liikmeid, kes on olnud ettevõtlusest 25 aastat. Ja üks nendest inimestest on Madis Avakuk. Kahjuks ta ei ole täna siin.
On ikka.
Oi, vabandust. Et kas ma võin Madist paluda, me tahaksime üle anda aukirja?
Kui juba nii saab meeldi, siis ma...
Miks võib sellest liigust ära? Vabandust, et mul on tähele. Et palju õnne EREA-le ja loodan, et teid on see, kes ennastus.
Aitäh ja palju õnne Madisele on kiinud esile. Our keynote speaker today is Dr. Carolyn Ramsey from Entrepreneurship Business School. Right after her speech, we are going to have a brief plenary discussion together with Mrs. Anne Samlik from Estravel. She's Chief Executive Officer of Estravel, and Mr. Tiit, Elenurm, the Head of Entrepreneurship Department here in EBS. But Dr. Ramsey's lecture is going to be about management learning and the cohesion between theory and practice in management learning. So, the floor is all yours.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting me to join your 25th birthday party. Can I say, I don't think any of you look a day over 21, so I think you're lying. You're not 25, I'm sure. Thank you for inviting me to share with you. And thank you. Once you invite me to share with you, then for all speaking my, or listening in, my language. Because my Estonian along with my Finnish, Russian, Spanish joke is not very good. I was struggling last night with thank you, so we'll move on. Today is quite an auspicious day, not just because of your 25th anniversary, but last night Nelson Mandela died. And I think a moment or two, if you don't mind, just to share some thoughts, because I suspect there are quite a few of us who are slightly older than 25, for whom this man is possibly the most significant man of our lives. I wonder if Estonians particularly feel something deeply about a man who led his people on a long road to freedom. And here is a man who, oh, I'm sure in 10 years we'll start to learn about the less attractive parts of him. He's a man, he's not a plastic saint. But his contribution to the world is almost entirely good. A transition from apartheid to co-living and peace. The bringing in of something akin to repentance and reconciliation into the public life. These are amazing achievements. A man who did good. I wonder how he learned to do that good. And in part, I'm going to come back to that question right at the end of this session. Because I'm interested today, not in how we learn to know more stuff. I'm really not convinced that knowing stuff necessarily makes you a good manager or a good human being. But learning to do, learning to be wise, skilled. What I call a practice-centered learning. So that's the topic. Just a little introduction, a little symbol here. The Open University is a think the largest university in Europe. I may be wrong. We have something in the region of 200 to 250,000 students, just a tad bigger than Estonian Business School. None of them, or very, very few of them, actually work on the campus. They live all over England, Wales, Scotland, and Ireland. And indeed, all over the world. I'm pretty certain if I look carefully around Tallinn, I would find at least one Open University, oh, in the corner, an Open University student. Welcome. I'm incredibly proud of the Open University. It's a university of second chances. People who didn't get school right study at the Open University. I was at a graduation ceremony just a week or so ago. I think I was in tears three times as I realized the learning journey that people had gone through as they learnt in their own homes using the materials we produce. And one of the dimensions of the way we work in the business school at the Open University is what we call practice-based learning. And I've been largely blamed for this. So you can see in the next few minutes how it went about. Now, I'm going to hope this works. Please work. It did work. I've been researching the issue of how we learn to do. Not learn to know, but learn to do, for about 10 years. Possibly one of the reasons why I haven't made huge progress in an academic career is I don't actually think that knowing is terribly helpful. And being a university lecturer when you don't really think much of knowing isn't a strong recipe for success. But I've been researching this subject for about 10 years. Here's a series of articles. For those of you sad enough, you can go and read them. Some of them are okay, and if you look hard, you'll even see some jokes, which is something of a rarity in an academic article. So how do business schools normally think about the relationship between academic theory and practice? They tend to think of it in terms of application. We teach you lots of stuff. This is what the world is like. This is what people are like. This is what organisations are like. And we give you some bits of kit to help you understand and look at and analyse. By and large, when business studies people talk about analysis, it isn't analysis. By and large, it's back of an envelope stuff. Get a bit of paper out, scribble a few notes, hope it works. Some recommendations, some ideas that come from researching the way business has gone on in the past, what has been successful. We bring in ideas from psychology, sociology, economics, and more recently, and this is where I fit in, philosophy. We bring the ideas, we stir them around, and we put them in a cafeteria where our students walk through and they say, what kind of bit of that? And a bit of that? And then we'll have a slice of that as well. And then they're supposed to go off and do it. Now, the problem is this doesn't actually work very well for a number of reasons. Firstly, people are endlessly creative. We never do the same thing two times running. It might look as if we do sometimes, but by and large, we are immensely creative. We are constantly doing new things, or doing old things in a slightly new way. Human beings are deeply unpredictable. We have loads of sayings. You will have Estonian examples. We talk about getting out of bed on the wrong side. Do you have an expression that makes sense to you? It's when somebody is really grumpy. I'm just going to make a joke there, and I don't think how we are getting into trouble. But we say they've got out of bed the wrong side. Oh, so-and-so is really good with kids. Or so-and-so's, and we have explanation after explanation about why people aren't the same. People are unpredictable. Do you remember Dennis Rumsfeld? He was an American politician, and he got himself into a terrible tangle a few years ago talking about known knowns and unknown knowns and unknown known knowns unknown. And he got himself in a real mess. Everyone laughed at him. It was, I thought, about the only intelligent thing he ever said. We're about to have a Rumsfeld moment in this room, so sit yourself back and relax. Do you know everything? Anyone here know any everything? All right, the accountants aren't in. No, we don't know everything. Now, the next question is, do you know what you don't know? Well, I don't know about astrophysics, but I really don't know what I don't know about astrophysics. If you don't know what you don't know, how can you possibly know how significant it is? If you don't know what it is you don't know, how can you possibly know how significant it is for your next action? And if you want an example of that, think of the Swiss watch industry, which, is anyone here wearing a Swiss movement watch? Anyone? If I ask that question the day this school was founded, 25 years ago, very nearly everyone would have been wearing a Swiss movement watch. The Swiss watch industry dominated the world. They didn't know about electronics. They didn't need to know about electronics. They were the best at the Swiss movement watch. It was just a damn shame that some wretched people at a company called Casio were designing a watch based on electronic pulses that would blow apart the watch industry. Within a matter of a few years, the Swiss watch industry was destroyed. Not knowing what you don't know is very, very dangerous. And the problem is, the more you know about what you do know about, the more you put on blinkers about the rest. That's especially true for us academics. Most of us academics get to know more and more about less and less. It's how we survive. We go mad. What do you mean we have gone mad? If we tried to know everything about it. So knowing is a deeply problematic idea when you link it to taking action. If you link it to writing an essay, knowing is dead helpful. And when I write those articles I put up there, knowing who said what and wrote what is very helpful. But when I come to live and decide and take action, knowing stuff is problematic. Being aware of things, now that's helpful. We'll come back to that. But our gaze is restricted. Our methods are inadequate. The methods of natural science work brilliantly in physics. They work less brilliantly in biology. They work less well in astrophysics, so both of those go and do computer modelling instead. And then they call it natural science. It isn't really computer modelling. The methods that we have for learning can be deeply problematic. So you've got all kinds of problems with the idea that somebody like Caroline gets it together and writes a nice theory, which you then read, memorize. I'll be testing you about this talk later. And then put into practice. The relationship between theory and practice is very, very problematic. She says, hoping that works. Still hoping it works. It works. So what's happening, what are we doing around about now that is helping us rethink learning to do, learning in practice? Well, firstly, we've rediscovered Aristotle's phronesis. Aristotle, in his book on ethics, wrote about different ways of knowing. He talked about episteme, which is the universal scientific knowledge. He talked about technique, which is know-how, knowledge how to do things. And then in the middle, he had a quality that he says was crucial for the good running of a state. Phronesis, practical wisdom. I want to suggest to you that what we want to be doing in business schools and management schools is not teaching theories and facts and things, but helping our students grow towards wisdom. I want to suggest that that would be more helpful. Various folks have explored similar sorts of ideas to me on this. Cook and Brown, Joe Raelin, David Beckett, have all used the phrase epistemology of practice. Epistemology, a way of knowing about practice. And some really good ideas in the midst of their work. Influential to me. But I want to suggest that actually wisdom isn't about knowing. It isn't about knowing at all. I want to suggest that it is a process, it is a practice of practice, a scholarship of practice. Scholarship that comes out of the library, out of the classroom, and goes into the workplace, into travel agents, goes into factories, goes into shops, goes into offices. A scholarship not of dusty books, but of living. A whole orientation. And I want to suggest that this scholarship of practice is not based on knowing, but is based on attention. It is based on what we pay attention to, what we notice, what we consciously, deliberately attend to. An engagement with ideas. Notice I'm not saying the application of theory. I'm talking about engagement. I wrote an article a while ago called Provocative Theory. Now, provocative theory is not about being provocative in the common sense way. I am provocative and I am offensive, and I'm sorry, I try not to be. But that's not what I mean. What I mean when I talk about provocative theory is I am interested not in whether a theory is true, I'm interested what people do with the theory. I'm interested what they experiment with. I'm interested what happens. Mike came to a session I ran with an improvised jazz band. Every year I get an improv jazz band in, they'd play for us and talk about what it's like to be in an improv jazz band, and then we'd discuss. How did that fit with management? Mark went off and used those ideas, this time working, because he didn't do improv jazz, he was and is a musician of ancient music. He plays beautifully instruments from about 1500. And he told me that Venetian polyphony, a form of music, surprisingly, coming out of Venice, was very improvised. And he used ideas from Venetian polyphony to train a group of senior nurses in leadership. Most stunning piece of work I've ever read. He didn't apply any theory. He explored it. He played with it. He pulled out the bits. He looked for the maybes in a theory. Practice of inquiry. John Dewey argues, pragmatist American philosopher, argues that ideas need to be tested for them to have any value. And not tested by some scientific academic, but by all of us every day as we use those ideas. And they won't just be academic ones. They'll be the ideas we get over a cup of coffee. The ideas that someone suggests to us. The ideas that come just as we're nodding off. I'm going to see. Anyone here like me, the best ideas I have just before I go to sleep, and I never remember them in the morning. One day I'll have the brains to take a notepad with me to bed and write them all down. I'll change the world then. One word which I am starting to like, mechanisms. What is going on? Yes, I might use a theory, for example. I might, one fashion in British schools recently has been for schools to produce breakfast meals for the students. They find that this helps students' attention. So that's the measure. They're producing lunch, breakfast for school children. The mechanism is how it works. They're not quite sure how it works. It might be that some very hungry children who don't get fed at home now have a good meal and therefore are able to concentrate. It may be that by coming to school early, they settle down and they're ready for the first lesson and they concentrate. They're not quite sure what is the mechanism. As we work and learn in practice, as we research in practice, we need to attend not only to what we're doing, but what is happening, what is the mechanism at work in making the world work as it does. Navigation of relations. This is the bit where I get really quite radical and suggest that the dominant element of organisational life is talk. And I hereby will offer any drink that you ask for to anyone in this room this evening if you can go and find a management textbook which has the word in English. It's got to be English language textbook, sorry about that. The word conversation in it. Now, I know of one, written by a friend who I like very much, disagree with him, but hey. Nobody, or virtually nobody, until the last 10 years or so, has researched talk and conversation in management studies. The topic that we know managers do all day, every day, from the start of the day to the end of the day, and nobody, until about 10 years ago, bothered researching it. It totally shapes what we can achieve. What somebody says to you will shape what you can say to them. The actions that your friend takes will shape the actions that you can do. Conversation is to managers what water is to fish. It's full of all complicated problems of power, of values, of interests. And we have to spend time noticing it, attending to it. If we don't navigate relations, we're going to be stuck. So the three domains of attention in practice-centered learning. So how does that work in practice? Mario, I'm hoping that you're going to wave at me just before I become really boring, okay? What do you mean you're waving now? What does it look like? Firstly, I want to suggest that most of this will best be done in work-based learning. I have done things in the classroom, case studies, role plays, that sort of thing. But by and large, the best way of exploring this kind of scholarship of practice is work with practicing managers who go off and do something. What we call at the Open University an evidence-based initiative. And we design the learning around an evidence-based initiative where they will have to take note of these three domains of attention. We work with theory not as true or false, but as provocative. We work with students evaluating how useful the ideas they met were. I got into this process of work-based learning because I was having real trouble, because I had this crazy idea that talk was important. And that took me down a particular route of philosophy called social constructionism, which was totally radical in an English business school. And I found it really difficult to teach it. Nobody would let me teach it. I got quite skilled at pretending I was going to teach that, and then I went off and taught what I wanted to teach. I got quite good at that. But work-based learning gave me the chance to talk with people about the issues that mattered to me and the issues that I thought were important to them as practicing managers. And of course, then they went to the workplace and they said, came back and said, "Caroline, it's a load of nonsense." Fair enough, I said, "Why? What's your evidence?" And they gave me some evidence. What was interesting to me was year after year, they would tell me in week two of the course that I was talking nonsense. Then they'd try and do a project at work, and they'd come up against all the political problems, all the communications problems, and they'd come back to me and say, "Caroline, didn't you say something about talk a while ago?" "I did." "Could you go over it again?" And we'd start. Well, we wouldn't start learning then. Actually, we were learning the whole time. We were learning in experience. We were learning as we engaged. Just as a carpenter learns as he or she works with the wood. You talk to a skilled carpenter or cabinet maker, and they'll tell you that every bit of wood is different. A carver
will tell you every stone is different. And they learn anew every time they work on a piece. Exactly the same. If you think blocks of wood are all different, if you think stone is different, as Michelangelo did, blow me down. People are different, don't you think? Every situation will be different. Every situation will need to be learned from the start again. But we now have, I want to suggest, a framework for exploring the moment-by-moment way that we work in jobs. So what are the stages of an evidence-based initiative? I reckon there are three stages. First stage I call mapping the terrain. Imagine you enter a room and you look around and you're going over to the bar, shall we say. Of course, none of you would. Well, maybe. The bar's over there and you're saying, well, there's a crowd there, so I'm going to go to the left of them. There's a stool here, there's a chair there's a table there. We map the terrain and we can do it at a glance, can't we? I came in the door, I saw a corridor down to the front. I came down, found a chair sitting there. We looked at it. Mapping the terrain. What needs to be done? What new needs to be done? What differences do we need to make? Testing plausibility. This is the moment where we work with colleagues to see whether they'll let us get away with it. Mark had real problems with the head nurse at the hospital he was working in. Kevin had real troubles with some of the gas fitters he was working with. He had to test the plausibility. Both of them had to modify the way they did their project so that they could make it happen. That's a stage of testing plausibility, taking action. It's not a neat and tidy three stages that one finishes and then, by and large, the whole process is going on the whole time. It's a constant process of evaluating and testing and asking questions. We can't do that. That's idealism, Caroline. We can't do that. We've got too many students. The course I run, using these methods on leadership and change, last year had 600 students on it. I don't think too many students affected. What is more difficult is work experience. That does cause problems. I use ICT, computer, a lot, discussion forums. I use templates and interactive activities. I use a number of online bits of kit. I work with action learning sets or peer groups for people to work with. But no work experience is a problem. I.e. people who are between jobs, people who haven't yet worked, they've come straight from school. This kind of methodology doesn't work for everyone. It doesn't work for every subject. No, if you are, for example, teaching corporate strategy, the average student is not involved in corporate international strategy. They won't be able to do it as part of their practice. Some subjects don't work for this method. I do think, though, that the time is coming where business schools need to reimagine themselves. away from teaching at the start of people's career to providing support, learning support, throughout people's careers. I am not convinced that many people are better managers because they do a bachelor's degree or a master's degree in business studies or management. Actually, most people learn their management when they're managing. Yes, many of them will remember the stuff they've read, and it will be helpful. I'm not knocking undergraduate business degrees. I think just like a history degree or an English degree or a science degree, business degrees have real value and helpfulness in learning to reason and argue. I'm not arguing against business studies as an undergraduate degree. But I do think we need to reorient learning towards lifelong learning, continuous professional development. I think we need to reward not the historic achievement of what I learned 20 years ago when I did my MBA, 22 years ago. 22 years ago, not that old. But that I want to suggest to you is something, that's a move we've got to make. It's not easy, actually. It will require us to be quite creative in terms of regulations and how we assess and accredit lifelong learning. But I think we've got to do it. One day they'll listen to me. If you know your Greek mythology, my name's Cassandra from Troy. I've been going on about this for years. There we are. So that's roughly where I've got to in teaching and where my research has got to in this area. Where is my research going? Where's my practice going as an academic? Well, it's focusing on that area, the navigation of relations. I've written about engagement with ideas, provocative theory. I've written about a practice of inquiry in a couple of places. Now I'm exploring how we build up conversational relations, how we navigate and work with each other in conversation. I've got two PhD students looking at judgment. I did an abstract search, an academic event about 2 years ago. I put in the subject matter is management, and a key word I said is analysis. There were 4,300 articles about analysis in management subject articles. I said, management, and keyword, decision making. 3,900 articles. Management, keyword, planning. Slightly less, 2,472. There's been another two since. How many articles did I find about judgment? Anyone willing to guess how many articles were there written about judgment in management?
Zero.
How many do you reckon?
Zero.
Zero. It was a little better than that. 4,500 articles about analysis. 17 about judgment. Can I respectfully suggest to you that when we look at the great crash of 2008, that there was analysis going on in our banks by the gallon, by the that's an English imperial measure, so there was a huge amount of analysis going on. I would suggest to you there was sod all good judgment in those banks. So, Joe, Claire and I are looking at judgment. Helen, David and I are looking at leadership. Not leadership on how can I be a great leader, but leadership is a relational process of conversation. How does it happen? How does it work? Interestingly, with one little bit of work that I'm doing at the moment, I'm busy writing it up at the moment, when I look at moments of leadership, as I call them, I want to see a leader. If you watch what happens in the conversation, two or three people shape and reshape the conversation into a different direction. There's in the two cases I've looked at in detail, there wasn't a leader. Too early to say that that's a principle that I can say is generally true. Two examples out of a one-hour interview isn't enough data. But I want to suggest to you, it's making me think differently. And here we come back to the point I started with. When I talked about Nelson Mandela and the good he has contributed. I want to suggest to you that in management studies, we work very well on the how. By and large, we leave the what we're doing to the business strategy people. And by and large, that is determined largely in financial terms. Can I suggest to you that that is a terribly restricted view about what creates human flourishing? Can I suggest to you that maybe we need to have a wider view of what management of an organization, of a community might look like in terms of creating human flourishing? What are the ethical issues? And what appalled me as I was writing about this scholarship of practice was that I had totally missed out the ethics. It was one of the reviewers. When you're writing academic, your article goes to peer reviewers, other academics. And one of the other academics who read my article said, I was horrified. How could I miss such an obvious thing? Well, the answer is, look at what we teach at most management schools and look at how invisible ethics are. They're just beginning to grow. Most MBAs and many undergraduate programs will include some teaching about ethics, largely focused on not telling lies, or corporate social responsibility. I would suggest we haven't got what Aristotle understood about ethics. What Aristotle understood that what it meant to be practically wise, because for Aristotle, he couldn't imagine calling anyone wise who wasn't working for the common good. The idea of working for your own selfish interest was just anathema. Minor detail that about 50% of us here wouldn't have counted in Aristotle's view of what counts as valid people, because women didn't count. But hey, he was a man of his time. We'll ignore and not go down the sexist line. Well, unless there's a good joke in there somewhere. How could I have missed it? Because I was letting what I paid attention be shaped by the people I was working with day by day. The navigating the relations, they were shaping what I had noticed. And I suddenly realized I'd missed out on a whole crucial area about how we learn to be good in managing. Thank you so much for listening to me. I hope you survived. I hope I spoke occasionally slow enough for you to follow. And I don't know if you want to just wait till we get together for the questions or whether anyone wants a clarification question now, but Anto, I will let you decide.
Thank you so much, Caroline. Do you have any questions to be asked before we start our discussion?
If it's okay, I will even ask two questions. One is, you mentioned best practice. Mm-hmm. In a way, best practice is established if we look backward on what has happened and we figure out which has been the best. And then, if we speak about new technology, new business models, we have to think about emerging or new practices. When you have practiced these concepts, have you also seen some tension between this best practice thinking, what can lead to success track, versus emerging new practices? That's one broader question. The other question is, well, we are running here such a project where we ask international student teams to assist some new startup to screen foreign markets and find business opportunities. Now, we have such a plan to make a joint curriculum with one British university. And as I understand, in UK it's very important to have external examiners. So I am wondering how such a practical field project will be assessed by external examiner in practice, because report, which is handed over to a startup, it's only one part of the project.
Thanks for those really easy questions.
Yeah.
The best practice historical, no, you make the point better than I did. And the whole process that we often teach of reflective practice is constantly looking backwards. When, I don't know about you, but I'm planning to live in tomorrow. I need a way of looking at the world that is not reflective, but projective. So there are all kinds of issues there, and that's the article after the one on leadership. The whole issue of best practice, though there are just so many problems. Because best practice is nearly always a local, and they're different for different places. The vast majority of the best practices that I've seen give untoward power to particular groups to decide who is doing the best practice. So there are all kinds of power. So best practice is something I guess I avoid as a teaching tool. External examiner, I think probably you and I, probably this is a kind of anal question that we academics get terribly excited about. How do we choose an external examiner? How do they work? It is immensely difficult, but there are people around who have experience. And when I'm doing externally for this kind of program, I don't just work with the project reports. I'm nearly always going to try and visit, a gathering of the students. I'm going to talk with the academics. There are ways of doing it. Is it a science? No. Can I offer good advice? Or, I think my friend Jeff Gold, who's my external
he can give me loads of good advice because we know enough, we've got experience of where the problems are likely to arise.
Thank you.
I was intrigued by your by the fact that you brought up all this analysis and judgment articles in management. But mainly due to lack of my English, could you please define judgment in management? And could you please say what's the difference and judgment based on what? Just elaborate on this judgment thing.
Can I wait till my PhD student, Joan, finishes her PhD in about 2.5 years and then I'll answer? You've just asked exactly the question that I asked. It seemed to me that when I did a bit of a research project working with a group of youth workers, a group of engineers, and a group of senior managers at a charity. And I worked with them exploring these ideas from a scholarship of practice. And the project went appallingly badly. It was very embarrassing. I was so stupid. But what I learned during the process was that I was changing my teaching methods as I went along. I started looking at what I'm noticing, what I was doing. For those of you who are doing PhDs, you'll be aware of the issue of reflexivity, which is a crucial element of the quality of doing, particularly qualitative research. And reflexivity often looks at how we interpret the data or how we affect the research field. What it very rarely does is look at how this research is shaping me. And what I noticed was that I was moving more and more to asking questions, something like a Socratic method. But it wasn't quite the same as Socrates and his method and the Socratic asking questions. What those questions were about was about taking a judgment on what to do next in the moment. It was different from analysis, which where you get a gallon load of, you know, a huge pile of figures and pump them through a computer and analyse them. That obviously has an element of judgment at the end when you make some sort of judgment about what's going on here. But the judgment I was interested in is that judgment about when to stop talking, when to go on. When to be encouraging to a student, when to read the Riot Act, when to get cross with them. Those kinds of moment-by-moment judgments. And what it seems to me is happening as I read more and experiment more and talk more, is that this kind of judgment is very much responsive. It's about being in a relationship and noticing what I'm thinking and feeling about a situation. Noticing that, for example, when I'm talking with managers about how they manage conversations, what I suggest to them that they ask themselves three questions. Is this a moment to persuade or accommodate? Is this a moment to open up or close down conversation? At this moment, do I like the way things are going? Because if I don't, I have to change something. So do you see that they're judgments which are a response to the relational activity, the conversation that we're a part of? It's a terribly half-baked answer to your question, basically, because that's why we're doing two PhDs worth of research about it. But it certainly seems to be, and I want to emphasize the physicality of it. It isn't just about our brains. I think sometimes we teach management as if the only thing that goes to work is our brains. So,
take our bodies out and send our brains off to work.
See you at the office then. And our whole body's there. And it seems to me it's a deeply sensual thing of being aware of what's going on. That these are going into places which not many management researchers have gone. So I'm suitably, hopefully, humbly puzzled by it. Not a good answer, I'm afraid.
Start. Listening to Caroline, I kind of moved back to my childhood. And once as a young bar boy, so I kind of took the road back to my childhood. And once as a young bar boy, my grandpa was a passionate fisherman. So that I think that fishing is easy thing, you know. The only thing what my grandpa suggested me to do is just pick up the right time, take the right instrument, go to the right place and start fishing. Just do your fishing. And I didn't get anything. And right then I went through the first management textbook. I started to think that management is easy thing to do. The only four things you have to know is, first of all, planning, second of all, organizing, third of all, leading, fourth of all, controlling. And if you do your planning, organizing, leading, and controlling in the right way, you become a perfect manager. However, right after I started practicing management, I understood that there is definitely something more I need to not only know, but I need to learn in its deep sense. So, Tiit and Anto, how would you explain what is this kind of mysterious something what a good manager, good leader, good entrepreneur has to experience, has deeply understand in order to become good in management?
Okay, if I may start answering. So, during your presentation, I was thinking about different shades of practice. And I remember in the 90s, some nice and slim ladies asked me to help them to transfer from Finland to Estonia wage watch movement or wage watch practices. And when I went to Finland, because Finland was authorized at that time to deal with Estonia and other Baltic countries and Eastern Europe, and one question what was I was asked was that okay, these ladies who are the initiators of the movement, have they themselves practiced of losing 10 or 20 kilos? And I didn't have an answer because I had such a feeling that they had also 5 years earlier been quite slim. So I think maybe the most complicated challenge is that how to live through something, how to live through crisis, how to live through success, and then how to make such reflection based on these very different practices. Next time, success and failure will not be exactly in the same way.
As well, 25th of anniversary. I have been working for the company 22 years and from that 13 years the managing director. manager, and I took over the project in the first project 13 years ago, and it was quite difficult because before that the manager and the owner was like a board in company, because he created the company, he was totally 100% the trading of the struggle. And then he decided one day that the climate is too bad, and he moved to Australia. He just sent me an email that, by the way, I am leaving and I am going to be the managing director. And it was quite a tough time to take over the company, because I started business, it's from continuous two parts. One is incoming to serving the foreign clients in Estonia, and the other part is to sending students to abroad. And I was manager of this income department, and it was only 10% from our turnover. And I didn't know nothing about the airline business, I didn't know nothing about the international travel trade stories. And when I started, the first thing that I did was I listened to people. All these meetings, I didn't speak the first half year, I just listened, I learned. And then I decided as well to whom I will listen in the future and with whom I will continue. For me, the most important is for the leader with whom you are working and with whom you are listening. And the main thing is listen to the people and make decisions. And like the travel business is very, very emotional, as you know, then your head must be very good sometimes, especially when it's a crisis. But everything I have been learned is very practice. I've been reading the books, but the books come to you when you need them. Those is real life.
And if you go through your long, successful career, what have been the most crucial events you have learned the most from? If you argue that management or leadership can be learned by practice mainly, then can you point out any kind of key events in your career?
The longest one and the best one for me was all this crisis. You feel and you learn from crisis. And then you know that you have to. The travel business anyway, you are working 24 hours and 365 days. This is our business. But when it's really, you have around 500 people around the world and you don't know how they can go back, how you can help them. And then you have five very good colleagues and you're sitting around the table and you are trying to find how to help them. And you don't have time because everyone is like the situation where they never have been. The crisis for me.
Caroline, I went through your article also. It seems to me that you just like and love and enjoy philosophy. If management and leadership can only be learned by practice, then we have also a nice saying from Kierkegaard that life can only be understood backwards, but we need to live ahead. From that sense or point of view, isn't it nonsense trying to teach how to manage, how to become a leader?
Yeah,
actually can't teach anyone to experience something.
Yes. Next question. But let me unpack that a little bit. Oh, I think I can probably be heard in back, can I? Okay.
My hobby is sailing. I have a little 4-meter dinghy called Eric. I'm very fond of him. Now, if you know anything about sailing, in light winds, when you turn around, which is called tacking, you have to roll tack. So you have to roll the boat to make sure you don't come to a total standstill, because you don't win races by standing still in your boat. Roll tacking is a totally felt experience. If you get it wrong, the boat falls over and you go for a swim. That doesn't help you. And if you go too quickly, then the boat doesn't roll. It just stays flat and it slows down. So somehow you have to get it just right. You have to move at just the right moment. And when you do it well, which in my case isn't very often, you can feel it. You can feel the boat move with you. No book on sailing that I've read tells me what that feels like. Tells me what it feels like to, so that I know I've got to move now, or the boat's going to fall over. Or tells me to slow down, you're moving across too fast. It's exactly the same in working with other people. It is sensual, we feel it. And no book can tell you. Oh, books can do an awful lot to help. But it seems to me that very few management books tell you what it feels like to be in a meeting that's going wrong. Very few management books tell you what it feels like to help somebody who's struggling. I remember once asking a manager, what was their biggest problem? And he said, oh, I've got this bloke who's in charge of the adverts. He gets the adverts for the cinema I manage wrong every week. So I said, well, what do you do to help him? Well, I tell him what's what, and I tell him what I expect of him. And he still makes a mistake. Yes. So what do you do to help him? I said, ask. Well, I tell him what's expected, and I tell him what's the information. And does he get it wrong? Yes. So what do you do to help him? It was the fifth time I asked him that he started to work out that he wasn't giving me an answer that was helpful. I think we need to change the way we explore management to look at those moment-by-moment ways of working. What it feels like, what it's like to get a meeting wrong, what it feels like when it's going well. I think that's where we need to explore. And that's what is learnt as you go through it. And I suspect we never notice when we're doing that learning.
Let's pick an example of swimming, for instance. And once you discover yourself swimming, you can probably swim, right? If you don't, well, sad story. Another option is to pick up a textbook on how to swim fast. So can you go through the textbook, you step into water, you move deeper, and you are trying to practice what you have read or gotten to know from the textbook. So do we have different students in business school, and we have various products and services we offer. So how do you think business schools can and should teach management or leadership in that sense? So we have different students entering university. What has a good contemporary university offer?
Can I take that? Because of course the swimming example is a really good one, because actually the best way of learning swimming is with somebody. You know, you go swimming and somebody is alongside you, helping you, coaching you. I suggested that I wasn't convinced that doing a course on management before you become a manager would help you be a good manager. I am absolutely convinced that there are no managers in Estonia or Britain who wouldn't benefit from spending time every now and again with an academic coach talking through issues about what it's like to be a manager in that place. I think this is part of what I'm saying about a change of orientation about business school life.
Well, if I could a bit elaborate on the swimming example, but to make it a bit more drastic, that maybe we are not speaking about individual swimmers, we are speaking about pilots of airplane. So indeed, airplane pilots, they also get some coaching, and when they make the first air pilot experience, they hopefully have some co-pilots instructors. But still, my point is that I would rather like to save taxpayer money or company money, that first they still a bit study what is the technical apparatus of the airplane and what are the measurement tools they should use when flying. And I would also recommend the same approach to different learning paths in university. So I'm more dealing with entrepreneurship than simply management. So I mentioned already one path is really that students can be in international teams, they can be some kind of gatekeepers. I would not call them consultants, but they could try to help already practicizing startup entrepreneurs to find the right foreign markets. And in this process, they are not maybe having the whole feeling how an entrepreneur feels and acts, but still they are a bit such co-pilots. They are doing some service to the entrepreneur, they understand what problems are complicated. They also understand that sometimes entrepreneurs are stupid. They change their mind, they don't follow agreed timetables, etc. So it's one path of learning. And the other path of learning is represented very well by Ylä Pika, who is sitting in this room, and it's student enterprises. And we have very bachelor level, we have student enterprise program, and teams of students have to set up their own enterprise. But I think it's a great learning, but I would say majority of these enterprises still they are not sustainable. So that's the challenge. And you are also dealing with student enterprises, but you are dealing with foreign students who come over here only for half a year or 1 year. And their readiness to be practicing members of entrepreneurship team, they are different or maybe more limited than capability and readiness of Estonian students. And then finally, if we come to the master level. At master level, I would say the majority of our master students already have good jobs. So their readiness to jump away, to give away the good job, and really to start from zero, entrepreneurial initiative, is quite limited. So we have to find maybe ways how to get them to CARAS 48 or to special brain hunt competition or to cooperate with technical. We can't think that majority of master level students will give away their present practice and jump to the water and start swimming as full-time entrepreneurs. Some do,
but majority not. So that's the reason why I'm advocating such multi-part approach.
Thank you. Caroline pointed out three important aspects of the scholarship of practice. First of all, engagement or attention with ideas. Second of all, practice of inquiry, and third of all, relationships or navigation of relationships. May I ask you, Anna, how would you tackle those aspects of scholarship in practice in your company? How do you help your high potential newcomers to become better throughout their career? How do you support your most experienced leaders? And how do you integrate students or those young people who have no work experience into your company?
I start from the end, the students, or how we find the new employees. We have today 135 employees in Estonia, and from that 111 is double consultant. They are the most important people for me. Some years ago, it was practice in Estonia that everyone tried to get better Java consultant, and they tried to buy them from the other Java agencies. We haven't done it, never. We really prefer to take younger people from school, and then they are normally going for us for the summer training, and we take normally more than we need. And then we already find out who is good for us, and then we ask them to join us. The process of coming in company, we have our in-house trainer, and all the new people we serve depends on the newcomers, but at least 1 month. And actually, travel business is quite difficult. The good travel consultant have to know at least 75 different booking systems. That it's not so easy. It's much more easy to book the flight tickets via internet, but our system is a little bit different. And the middle management and the top management, how we find the people, the middle management, we really prefer to find the people in-house. If we don't have, then yeah, we have to take them outside, but the top management as well, in the first choice is our own people. How we motivate them to know the most motivation is traveling. This is good. And we have tradition with our top management that we have once a year trip to some nice countries. We just arrived back from Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Kuala Lumpur and Pune.
It's very, very difficult. I think I am speaking largely from a perspective of what can we in a business school do to help our students and to help our alumni learn and keep learning. One of the really big problems that you face learning in the workplace is that the majority of people don't like to think of themselves as learners. When they're in the workplace, they're professionals. And they're doing their job, and they're doing what they know how to do, and they're experienced, and they're sure-footed. For a large number of people, learning is something you only do in the classroom. And an awful lot of people have a huge brick wall between the idea of learning and the idea of practice. And one of the problems I faced with the research I did was I couldn't get and encourage the guys to try new things. It was too dangerous for them,
too risky. And for the learning process I was encouraging them to go through, they had to try new things. And we would then have a talk. So for them, they became of the view that Time with Caroline was just a talk shop. It wasn't about what they were doing. One or two were different, and they really made a progress.
We argue that learning cannot happen where there is not sufficient self-confidence. Or
that's one element, certainly. But there is this funny difference. And it's not just me, several researchers have spotted that this problem of workplace learning, that people aren't learners. And if you go to talk to them about learning in the workplace, they will resist you very much. Now, there are obvious moments when you start a new job that people are sensitive to what they've got to learn the processes, a travel agent or in the travel, that particular sector of industry. I would suggest that often what is going on there is you're learning some norms which will help you learn to spot when things are going wrong. So that actually even this is a process of helping you notice and attend to, whoa, something's going wrong. Or something's, there's an opportunity here, or whatever.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you like to ask anything from any of our panelists? Yes, please.
I have a couple of questions. One is for Anna, and the other is for Caroline. And it's around where you mentioned academic coach. From Anna, I would like to ask, what would be your expectations for an academic coach? And from Caroline, some ideas, hints, or clues how to build up such a system.
You mean academic coach, but I have some person with me who is theoretic person, or what do you mean the academic coach?
I understand that academic coach, Caroline can elaborate on that, but my understanding was that this is a person from academia, a professor or somebody who works in academic world and who could support in a coaching for business people. This was my understanding.
I think the problem we have is that this is a role which I think we need to develop. I don't think it exists.
Okay, but
I know the issue of life coaching is growing in importance, certainly in England. Mm. I don't know if it's happening in Estonia. I think that a large number of major companies are now employing coaches for their senior staff. If you think about it, the top tennis players all have their own coaches. Why do we think that being a manager of a business is any easier than being a tennis player? Unfortunately, I haven't yet persuaded my good friend Julian, who is chief executive of Old Mutual, to give me 10% of his income. I'd be very much better off I'd be able to give up my job on 10% of his income, but it hasn't worked yet.
So we are not concentrating so much on the academic background of the coach, but rather a coach as a mentor, coach as a business coach, right?
At the moment, yes, but I do think that there is a role for academic, somebody who's researched, who looks at business in a different way, who has different perspectives, and can talk just differently and spark off new ideas. I just think there is a role for that which we should be exploring as business schools. We might be a bit more helpful to the Estonian economy.
Okay, now I understand. And what I do today it's very much the same, but not academic coaching. If I need some good ideas, or I really need outside new ideas, then I have very good friends with the other leaders from the other areas, like telecommunication or banks, and we have lunch together. And I get answers.
But would you consider having academic coach?
Why not? Why not? Because, as you know, if you, for me, the leisure time is three period. When you are starting, then you're very fantastic. You would like to do everything right away, and you are very, very active. Then the second part, you are quite established, everything is okay, you know everything. And then the third part is you have to feel the right time when you have to leave the company. You can't stay too long. I have been telling the funeral a long time. If I say to my colleagues, they have good new ideas, like let's do mobile web or let's do this or that, and I say for the three good things that no, I am against, then I have stayed too long. But the established time, the first period is the nicest one, and the second one, you can't be there as well very long. You have to create all time how to be, how is your future? Because in the travel business, there is right now no good idea to look back. Our business is changing too quick. There's nothing to do with history.
Academic coach, that was a new concept for me. How about you? Do you consider it important business people to have someone as academic coach to be talked to?
Well, actually, I would be very happy also if we would clarify different rules. We can speak about coaching, we can speak about mentoring, we can speak about supervision. They are all a bit different things. And last but not least, there is also what is called the process consulting in companies. So I personally think that such a personal coaching in narrow sense, really, it means asking right questions from another person. And I think part of people need it. But I think that's very much a domain of psychologists, such personal coaching of managers or any other people. But then if we come to the broader arena, I think it's still what in many companies is needed, is process consulting. It is bringing people together who are sitting in different departments, having some kind of problem solving sessions, to give these people who are really in a large, a big bureaucratic organization, new views, which partly are also coming from inside the organization. Maybe what is called process consulting, I think for some people it also has a label now, some kind of team coaching, but it's something which has been established in organization management field already maybe 40, 50 years ago, but it's gradually developing. So I personally think that academic people can give more input to process consulting inside organizations.
Thank you. Are there any more questions? Yes, please.
I was a bit curious. You see, for this kind of organization, business organization has a pyramidal structure. And let's presume it has a tertiary sort of a system. So you have the lower level, who are the entry level people, or people who come in as trainees, and people who have just started their careers. And then you have the middle level, which is like managerial or more, you know, on that side. And then you have a higher level, the uppermost level, which could be considered perhaps the board of directors or, you know, people with management affairs, not the affairs of the company. Then would it be possible that perhaps mentoring is more cost effective? effective at the lower two levels, and because you know internally you would have structures for people to talk about experience and things, but if you are looking at the topmost level, they don't really have anyone to turn to within the organization. Would that be a case?
I think that the people at the top of industry can be incredibly lonely. And I think that there are conversations there that can be had where it doesn't have to be an academic, for goodness sake. But what fascinating element is if you look at where training budgets are spent, huge amounts are spent on leadership training. Do you know, I once said to somebody, can I train your people on how to be good followers? Because I worked on the basis that if I was doing leadership training, I would help a few people at the top of the firm. If I could get the people at the bottom, the huge numbers, if I could get them all performing 10% better, and so I designed a course on creative followership. And I, as a little test, I took it round with me, and I couldn't sell it. One bastard said, oh, could you do me a course on leadership? So I hit him. He was a good friend, and he gave me. But it's really interesting. I'm not sure you're right. I think training budgets go not on the large numbers. I think training budgets go, the amount of money people spend, companies spend, sending their executives over to Harvard for a six-week jolly on executive leadership is just mind-numbing.
Anna, would you like to have a comment on that? Is it really so that most of the executive training budget is spent on the top dogs?
No, totally not in Estonia. And I think that in Estonia, here is no such big companies. We are a small country and our companies are so small. And I don't think so that in Estonia we are spending so much money for the top management. And by the way, the most important is the middle management in company, because they are between employees and from the top management. They are the person who have to go to talk about something that tell them the bad news and the good news. And they are really middle. And you have to take care of them.
Did you also have a comment on that?
If I may add, indeed, this leadership is important because to inspire people, middle-level managers are important, and followers are important, but I think if we now go towards more knowledge-based society and knowledge-based organizations, there is one very specific practice that has to be learned, and that's how you teach your boss. So, especially in such organizations where people are specialists, experts in some fields, then the real challenge is how to help your boss to learn new things, because you can't assume that, as in such old-fashioned hierarchical organization, that big boss knows everything about what the work what is done in organization, and that's the real challenge, already highlighted by Peter Drucker.
My last question to you is about leadership theory and practice. And may I kindly ask you, Caroline, to be the last one to answer. There's a good old saying that nothing can be as practical as a good theory. The crucial question, the key question for me, is how to transform a knowledge into practice. And how can we as managers, as leaders, help our colleagues and subordinates to transform their knowledge into practice? So, to put it even simpler, how can I help my subordinates to get the advantage of what they know at workplace.
The question was to you.
No. I just asked Caroline to be the last one to answer.
Right. Oh.
So, but yeah, you can go first.
I don't know, I'm going to be in trouble now. Oh well, hang it, I'm going to be in trouble. Look, if you want leadership in your organisation, and I think leadership is crucial, then the worst thing you can possibly do is get any leaders. Nothing kills leadership quite like leaders. I normally get bricks thrown at me when I say that, but I'm still going to say it. Can I suggest to you, recently some folks wrote about leadership and they said the crucial outcomes of good leadership are some sense of commitment, some sense of planned outcomes, and some alignment of different groups working together. So, if I said to you, guys, what we need are some shared goals, alignment around those goals, and commitment, I would suggest to you that not one person would say, what we need is somebody to come and do it for us. What we would all do is say, design conversations whereby we work out what are the goals that we share, we would work out how to sort ourselves out, align ourselves, and then we'd encourage each other. Now, I know I'm exaggerating to make a point, but leaders get in the way. All our teaching at the moment about leadership is dominated by how we get people to lead and we become leaders. What we desperately need to do in organisations is to develop the conversations. And some of the conversations don't involve words, they're acting conversationally. Because sometimes we don't have time to get around for a nice cup of coffee and a chat. But it's about noticing and working with and aligning ourselves with. And you will see this in improvised theatre, you'll see this in improvised music. Leadership happens between, not by somebody imposing and leading. And I don't think I'm going to be out of a minority of one in asserting that, but hey, I said it.
I would very much like to applaud on your vision and words, but I think that's the field where really organization and management theory and practice has the biggest contradiction, because if you take all the guru books, that's the dominating theme for last two decades, learning organization and I think also these new books about leadership, they were very much focus on involvement and participation and participative leadership, etc. But I'm sorry, I personally think here we have to make a difference between different type of organizations. Some are really such, I would say, by the logic industrial traditional organization, and there can be a slogan of full commitment and participation, but it doesn't work fully. And maybe in other extreme, there are already knowledge-based organizations where it's not possible to lead without really consulting and having common goals and alignment. So I would use the situational approach.
Your theory is difficult Well, I just would like to say that what is important for me, we're a small company, just only 135 employees, and for me the most important that I have to be on place all the time for my employees. And I have time to talk if the person needs my help. And if somebody is not on the right place, I can feel it, then it's my fault to tell her or him and help to find the right place to work. For me, the employee must be twice happy. In the morning, when she's coming to the job, and in the evening, when they're going at home. If the boss happy time, then it's everything is good.
That's a beautiful thought to conclude.
Thank you so much, Anna, Tiit and Caroline, for joining us in this conversation. Thank you for being here. There is coffee and snacks served right after you exit the room. And those were the stories today. Next time, next birthday, new stories. Thank you so much. Enjoy your evening.